college, and I know a lot of missionary kids, and they would talk about how they had to spend a whole year home in the States visiting 25, 30 churches
every week traveling.
So we really tried to
start
most of our stuff in Michigan so that when we come home, we can spend most of our time in Michigan. So that's why I was kind of excited that we had a church here in
Madison. We're kind of odd. We're out in the West, and we're standalone, right?
Yeah. Well, and we come in on the West Coast, so we could always...
Yeah, it was convenient to be able to stop on the way out. So. Well, so it was kind of interesting because I really felt like, you know, obviously our home church was said right away they'd do 10%, and the other sending church was like, you know, they can do about 5%. And so then we're like, well, where's the rest of 85? And come on, God. But we had several family members throughout the country that were like, yeah, we're on board with this. And a few really good friends over the years who joined it right away. But that only got us about 25%. And so it was like, well, where are we going to go from here, God? And it was really cool because, I mean, I would say most of it, I started reaching out in the Ludington area, which is our second church, basically. Reaching out to the different churches there. I probably had, I don't know, 7 different churches, I think, in the area come on board with our ministry. And then we had friends who would bring us to their church, and their church would sign us up. So Michigan's definitely our primary place. We've still got family and friends in Nebraska who joined up. My mom and my sister are from Missouri. So Midwest, for the most part. There's a church down in Dallas that one of our friends on the field connected us with.
That's a really cool story. So this church down in Dallas, we went and visited it with the old directors in the Solomon Islands. And that they have a Sunday school class there that has been praying for them. And anytime they have prayer requests, they pray for them. One of the prayer requests is that they would have an operations manager. They've been praying for 5 years for an operations manager. Well, we didn't know that they were praying for that. So then when we went to this church with the directors, and we happened to be in Dallas, they introduced us as the answer to the prayer that they've been praying for the last 5 years. And they were like, awesome, that is awesome.
And we thought that was really cool, and we didn't believe.
Yeah, we were going to ask them to support us. We were already supporting people, you know, of the directors or whatever, old directors. And then somebody said, are you going to ask us? And we were like, well, we weren't going to, but...
Well, I would not impose myself. And he goes, but doesn't God want you to share it with everybody and ask them to participate? And I was like, well, that's true. I was like, I will send you an email with our information. He's like, okay, good.
So we asked them, and they came on
board. Yeah, they came on board to represent. You know, I was like, really cool. So
Texas has got some stretch.
Yeah, apparently. That was just their Sunday school class.
Yeah, just the class.
I was like, wow, you guys, and we were one of, well, missionaries. And that's just the missions of the Sunday school. I'm like, wow, you guys are like invested.
Very active.
It was awesome. It was really very encouraging.
So let me, the last question on your questionnaire has you basically have covered almost everything on the questionnaire.
Okay.
Right? We just like you to take the time to fill it out. It would be interesting for you to fill it out, you to fill it out, and compare your answers, and then send it to us.
Okay.
Okay. But it's Katie, I'll address it to you. Operations manager, ministry there, talk to us besides homeschooling 5 kids is a monstrous ministry, okay, or is a monstrous ministry. What's your dream, what's your thoughts and so forth about your life and your, you know, am I just a missionary mom, homeschool teacher, you know?
Yeah, first of all, I'd like to say that Wycliffe allows the moms a year or two even, no pressure, just get your families situated, which I really appreciated. Getting 5 kids used to living in another culture was a big concern of mine, so that there wasn't any pressure to like, now jump in and do your hours was really encouraging to me. But another really cool thing that happened was we're gonna live on the center, the translation center. They have houses. And they have homes where they can, the missionaries from the villages, and they have the islands, they come and stay there, do their paperwork, government stuff, get supplies, go back. And it's kind of a short-term thing. They come there and they go back. And a lot of times the kids have been kind of like, oh, there's nobody to play with here. And so I thought it was really neat that here God's given me 5 kids from 16 to 5. There's somebody in there that you guys can play with. And so kind of this aspect of us being a host family, we're very hospitality-minded. It's one of my gifts, I think. groceries in their apartment when they come, so they don't have to rush off to the market to buy stuff or make some muffins or whatever, just to be a welcoming kind of committee was really exciting. So that's probably what we'll start doing as soon as we're comfortable. And then as far as dreams go, they do have a scripture engagement, what is that, 14, that's the 14, of people who work with, okay, now you have God's word, it's not just sitting on your shelf, right? Like you're doing, it's getting used. And so I just love the Bible. I just love encouraging people in the Bible. So I am excited in kind of digging into that part of the ministry, that branch, I guess you could say, of encouraging people. I have background in working with moms through MOPS. I don't know if you guys are familiar with MOPS. Getting mothers together, doing a Bible study or something. So just looking to see how I can reach out to women and encourage them to read their Bibles or get them to their Bibles or whatever.
Yeah, thank you. Anybody else? Questions?
What's your attitude on guests?
Desks?
Guests.
I go flying over there and I say, I need a place to stay tonight.
So one of the buildings of the center itself, I'll be helping to be the operations manager. Is actually five houses grouped together in the middle of the city there, and one of them they've converted into more of an office space kind of thing. But the rest are all just houses that they use whenever people will come and go, like regularly. And as they come in, they go and they stay in these places temporarily while they then transition on out to the village or out of the country. And they'll do like workshops and other training seminars and stuff, and they'll bring in not only the missionaries but their national translators that they're working with developing. They'll bring them in and do studies and workshops on various topics. And so it's really kind of a neat thing that they can do. And so one of the things they do quite regularly is host international guests who are coming in, usually for a specific project or whatever. But I know they do building and other type of labor things as well. I know I was reading an article about a guy that was, I don't know, 5 or 6 years ago, who he was some kind of engineer or some kind of guy who, in his host country, I think it was Australia or something like that, and had all this experience and stuff. Well, he shows up, he's right away using his backhoe and digging and doing all this, you know, changing the way water flowed in the area to help drain better and all this other good stuff. So, you know, I know they use that kind of stuff. I don't know personally yet what we'd be able to use people for, but like I said, I already got two churches that are talking about sending people in a couple of years, so I gotta start looking at that when we get out there, what they can use, how they can help. One of the things that's constantly a hard thing for them is whenever they do get people together, they'll try to bring in as many as they can, because some of these guys have lived out in the field for 15 years and never met some of the other guys that are out in the villages because they don't interact with each other. And so every once in a while they might get an opportunity to meet up at the same conference. And so one of the hardest parts is bringing their whole family, uprooting them from their regular life in the village, to then go to this conference for a week and a half where there's not going to be anybody they know or any programs for them. And so one of the most recent ones I heard of was a church that put together a kind of like a VBS kind of thing for the kids and projects for the spouses who weren't involved in translation to help them work on other things and have a fun get together that was kind of more beneficial to the whole family. So I don't really know exactly what kind of projects it would be, but I know that they are happy to have visitors. And it's just they don't usually get so many because it's so remote. And that's what the things so hard.
What about an emergency plan? Let's just say, God forbid, somebody comes down with appendicitis.
Yep, that's part of our cost is a higher than what I would normally say is okay, but that WICA requires of us insurance, which includes evacuation. So if there's some kind of medical emergency, usually most people from where we're at would end up going to Solomon Island or to Australia for help. And unless it's something that's not quite so bad, they might take them to PNG, where there's a few different hospitals that are a little bit better than what's available. So that's the official. We have it covered. Wycliffe doesn't want us to have to make that choice of whether or not we spend $100,000 saving our kid or just saying, well, go with God, you know. And it's like, that's one of the things that's kind of thankful that we didn't have to make that choice. Wycliffe's like, sorry, we're not having that on our hands.
The box, Denny was flown out on one of those evacuation flights with a personal nurse to France.
Wow.
Yeah. So, and that's that insurance.
Yeah.
Company.
Because, so, I mean, it can really cost a lot of money to moves, you know, those things around that quick, and that's.
And what is medical care on the islands? Is it?
They have a hospital. I went and took a medical missions intensive course. It was 2 weeks of, I don't know, it's kind of a boot camp. what a true emergency is. I feel like in the States, it's really easy to be like, oh, I don't know, we're just gonna go to ER. You know, like, let's just be safe, let's take them to the ER. And you won't really have that over there. So I was able to really learn, okay, what is a true emergency? What is like, give it an hour or get there now type thing. So the hospital's gonna be good for like, if somebody breaks a bone or, you know, maybe even appendicitis. I'm not sure with surgeries yet.
Yeah, it may sound like you don't really want to risk surgeries necessarily, but.
But we have to take in like our own instruments in case they don't clean or they're reusing or something. Like in America, you don't reuse instruments ever, or you sterilize them or whatever. And so I learned what to take for that, and so I'll be taking those for us in case we have to go to the hospital for whatever reason. So.
And that was where the other aspect of that is that for the most part, anything more than a broken bone or a simple basic, very major, you know, maybe removing something that should be growing on your skin or whatever, other than that, you probably don't want it done there anyway. But what is available, if we go in for anything that's in between that range,
they'll dedicate all
their time, attention, efforts, and energy to us, neglecting even their own people. And so it's kind of like.
They're very much a host culture, very much guests. Are important. So we don't want to take advantage of the medical system because it is free too.
Yeah.
So there's no cost to use the hospital. So I will have medical things, I will have first aid and try to do as much of it that I can at home.
That leads me to my next question because we just finished, you guys heard of Lee Strobel.
Yeah.
We just finished reading The Case for Miracles.
Okay.
And if you get a chance, it's beyond. And what we found is where most miracles are taking place are in third world countries.
Oh, right.
Because they don't have the medical care, they don't have those things. And so my next question is, have you seen or been a part of, or what's your belief system on miracles? Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I don't know if we've really ever formed
He's from a more conservative background. I'm from my mom is saying, she goes to an AG church. Church, so I'm more of a charismatic background, so I'm more comfortable. I've seen more than maybe Josh has. But I also think like the story of Faith Like Potatoes, where he brought someone back from the dead and it died.
Yeah.
And so I know, especially in third world countries, dreams and things are more prevalent. In college, I had to spend 6 months in Kenya in a Muslim community, and over you would hear Muslims say that they had a dream of somebody telling them to go talk to a missionary.
Amen.
Mm-hmm. Go find the missionary and go hear about the good news, and then they would find that way. So I know that it's there. I know that God can do anything. I wouldn't say that, there was one time. He stopped moving in my womb. And it really freaked us out, and it was like hours.
Yeah, he was the most active child.
Yeah, he was always moving, and then
Anna might get more active, but he was always kicking and moving, and then he stopped.
He just stopped, and no matter what he would move. And my mom called her pastor, and he met us at the hospital. And I remember coming up to the counter, and he like just leaped like in my room, like just came. I feel like I don't know, but I feel like he just came back. So I know that God does move that way. It can be tricky sometimes. How much do you depend on modern medicines, and how much do you trust?
That's why I want to encourage you, if we couldn't, or give you the book ourselves, because when you read this book, Lee Strobel is very he's very step by step, goes fully medical, takes nothing for granted. If anybody says miracle, he's like, he does all the research to say, is this legitimately a miracle? And so I'm encouraging you guys, because you're going to be in an environment where, let's face it, other people that you're going to meet, if something happens to them, they have nothing.
Right.
Well, and they even, because of the areas where they don't have the word of God and they're not utilizing it, there are lots of shamanistic type practices that are expected to cure you. And perfectly within their belief system. I believe in Jesus. Now I got to talk to this doctor about performing certain rites to make sure that my kid's well.
Right.
And it's like a total disconnect there. And so I feel like there is a certain aspect of that that is definitely needs to be on our regular radar. And as far as what I grew up with was that old notion that, you know, miracles had their point, but then all those miraculous gifts were done. That's what I was just taught. So I always believe that. And so that was challenged in college. and he, ever since, I've always been like, well, you know what? God tells us, and I love the way that a good friend of mine, one of the pastors of the churches that supports us, he's I don't know what their official church type is, or an independent of some type, but he's very much more charismatic than what I would say I am at all. And he's like, you know, basically, here's my thing. He's like, I believe that the Word of God tells us very clearly to be praying for the sick, and pray for health, pray that God will heal these people, and trust that He will. And you know what? If He does, amen. Praise God. I'm glad I got to be a part of that. And if He doesn't, I can still trust God that this was His plan, and it's okay. And, you know, so it's really kind of a neat thing to shift my thinking and be able to see that, because that's what I feel like, if there's going to be an opportunity, it's going to be us living out the Bible where He tells us to pray for the sick, pray for that kind of thing, pray for healing and miracles, and be trusting in our good God to do what He thinks is best, and to grow people in the faith in that. And
but
so
I just don't want to give it a label. You both said charismatic, and that's...
and that's unfortunately in our culture is so widely pinpointing you.
Lee Strobel's not. He's Reformed Presbyterian.
Yeah.
That's why I'm like, let's put those labels on.
Yeah, and that's why it's hard to try to pinpoint any.
We met a missionary family whose daughter got sick in Papua New Guinea, and they were trying to decide if they should evacuate her or what they should do, and the church found out. So this new church, and they had just gotten their New Testament, and they heard she was sick, and the elder showed up with oil, and they anointed her and prayed for her, and they didn't even ask for it. They did that just from their reading of the Bible, and she was healed. She was fine the next day. So there's definitely evidence for it, and it definitely gives you confidence when you're following the Lord to where He's taking you, that He's going to take care of you.
Right. Yeah, because you don't want to go in. As soon as you hit panic mode, you don't even think straight.
Right.
Let me wrap it up here. Jeff.
I was just going to ask, what is your guys' church situation going to be when you're in the Solomon Islands?
Apparently, in the capital itself, there are a lot of churches and a lot of languages, because it is the focal point of all the expatriate communities as well. So you have a representation from almost every language group in the Solomons in the capital, plus then many different dozens of languages from outside the world. And one of the examples they gave me was that you could go to any one of four different German-speaking churches in the middle of the city. So there's a lot of churches, there's a lot of opportunity. I mean, most likely we'll probably start off with some of our expatriate friends at the mission and whatnot, but they really want us to get involved with the nationals and to become friends, the people that will keep us there, because the other people coming and going are not going to be why we stay. It's going to be the people we're invested in there. And so, I mean, we'll probably, our hope would be to eventually get involved in the local church and we'll have to learn their language as well, because they probably won't even be doing the common language is pidgin, and that's what we'll have to learn to do business. But in churches, they usually will gather together in their local language groups. And so, whatever we end up in, we might need to learn a second language as well that's a real language that
amen.
Works
with
that.
Yeah.
Amen. So that would be our goal, to get involved locally.
Yeah. Gary.
Jeff kind of yanked it from me. But tell me about your family worship. What do you guys do right now? And I mean, he kind of touched on the church part, but how are you planning while you're there to grow spiritually? And
one of the best things that my wife ever did with homeschool was get our kids into memorizing Bible verses. And never would have thought anything big about it. I mean, it was a big part of my life as a kid, but I never thought twice about it when we started having our own kids. And so it's really cool, because one of the things that I love to see them do is they'll, like, posters? So they'll make these posters, these verses that they're memorizing, and stick them up on the walls, and it's like that keeps God at the center of our schooling, at the center of our home, at the center of our house, and it's like, and that really makes it more practical to me, where I feel like, you know, I'm just making sure that every morning, afternoon, and evening kind of concept, we are focused on God, and it's like that kind of incorporation into our education process, I really think is probably fundamental to how we worship together as a family. And so we tried different things, like doing hymns together, and we ended up listening to, we ended up listening to more music, whatever, you know, one fun, whoever's playlist at that moment, they were doing more.
Yeah.
Yeah, different worship music, and we jump around all over different genres, but I mean, we've tried multiple different things. There was a time where we were trying really hard, you know, to do the Sabbath concept really well. Like, okay, we gotta do the Sabbath thing. How does it work? And so wrestling with trying to figure out how does that still honor God, yet operating in the liberty of Christ. How do we do this? And I feel like we've found a good balance. Well, that's one of the things kind of neat, because then with Wycliffe, one of the things they were like, look, we don't believe you have to obey the Sabbath, but we think you do need to Sabbath in a regular process somehow, some way, to find your rest and relaxation in God and rebuilding and restoration in Him regularly. So do it individually, do it with the family, whatever. And so we try to make sure we do that, which is kind of hard. Like, you know, this last 3 weeks that we've been pretty much constantly traveling, you know, we've got to take time to just rest in Christ. And it's, yeah, probably the biggest thing.
So we do it daily just with school. We'll do it daily, devotional in the mornings, whatever. So I really do. That's my favorite part of homeschool, being able to.
We have some weird questions.
Start off on
that. But wait, isn't that why we believe this? And it's like, we don't believe that. Where did you get that? So, great. It's great stuff. It's great stuff.
All right. You know, everybody else here, we've got these missionaries up here on the wall, and I don't know, Stacy, when I got their email or something, but I can't remember any of these missionaries. This guy, they communicate more than any of these other people up here.
Yeah.
Okay. And I want to commend you for that. I firmly believe, in my years, I taught this foreign missionary up here, a part of your ministry is those who are on your team. Okay. And already I think you're showing that, all right? One of us here will be your communication point.
Cool.
It's not the head dude.
Okay.
Here, don't.
Well, the Bradys have already been hugely in contact with us.
So you need to understand that. You'll find out who you communicate with.
Okay.
And we put up here, we laminate a newsletter.
Okay.
Right? One page newsletter, one sign.
That's
our goal.
And when it comes, we photocopy it in color and put it in our church program.
Okay.
And then we have prayer for them at that particular time.
Awesome.
And putting specific prayer requests, 3, 4 down there, is very, very helpful to that layperson who's going to lead that in prayer.
Can you print it if we email a PDF? Is that something
that's yeah,
so
yeah,
we
yeah.
don't have to like mail it from Psalms?
No.
PDF.
Okay.
Yeah.
Just digital.
So every 3 or 4 months, somewhere along in there, it is you need to send us a video.
Okay.
Okay. Maximum 2 minutes.
Okay.
And we show it to the
okay.
We show it up here. Please test the audio clarity. Don't bury it in some lockbox, Dropbox, something box. It's hard to get, right? It doesn't have to be professionally done in a studio. And the last one I thought was probably one of the best ones, the Egyptian missionaries, they have a 19-year-old, a 14 or 15-year-old girl. So they all greeted us. And the young girl, she greeted us and said, I'd like to play you something on the piano.
Oh.
She played a little short piece on the piano.
Cool.
Okay.
Keeping you
remember that. I want to tag on to that. So John Piper says you have the goers, you have the senders, and you have the disobedient. And we're the senders. You know, we're, you know, all the people on the board, we're the senders, and we want to be updated. We want to, you know, it brings us joy to see how God is working in your lives and the lives of the people at the Solomon Islands as well. So
yeah. So Derek is in charge of Justin and Shannon O'Hare with Pioneers Missions, and they are our rookie missionaries. They are due back this year after two years
Jordan.
Of language school in Amman, Jordan.
Mm.
Okay. And I'm hoping Derek is going to be, you know, kind of taking care of them, and when they come back,
cool.
We will then go to sit with them and interrogate them, interrogating you.
Deep breathe.
You know,
that's a good word.
You know, and they've sent you 1 or 2 videos or 1 video and such, you know,
cool.
That kind of thing.
What's interesting though is you guys have 5 children. They're just planning to have 1.
Yeah. Sharon O'Hara. Pray for, we're asking that when they come back in November, she's got her belly full.
Aww.
Yeah. But it's not with five, but
that will be full.
So, Josh, in one minute, because you're very verbal, which is okay, I'm very verbal, okay? So, how are you blessed? Blessed is the man whose quiver is full.
Yes. I was going to say my wife, but I guess I'll add my kids too. I don't know. I would say definitely my family is one of God's chief blessings for me. Did not have the best relationship with my dad growing up, and I always struggled with that. And then when we got married, I was looking forward to having a father-in-law, and that didn't really happen. And so it was just like, you know, I always kind of feel like I was missing that out in life. And yet, one of the coolest things with this process has been all the pastors who really invested in our lives, I've been able to become really good friends with in that process. Some of them are kind of more like brothers than father figures, but and it's been a really good thing there. And so then to have my wife with me in that whole process, and our kids on board with it too in their own unique ways, has been probably the biggest personal blessing, I would say, in that. As far as the overall, as far as in my walk, I would say that the biggest thing I've seen God is be faithful. And I don't always understand it, and I look back at the 20 years of I don't know what God's doing, and I still don't know what God's doing, but I see what he is doing, and I say, he is faithful to do the good things that he said he'll do, just like stepping in that river. You know, he told me to do it, so I'm doing it. We came out west, and that's what we're doing. And it's like, I don't know where that's going to go, but I know that now I've stepped into it. I'm expecting him to do something. I don't know what it is. My assumption is pull the water back, but whatever it is, I know I can trust him because he's good and he's faithful.
Anybody else before we close?
I just want to encourage you to keep good records, especially if you do lay hands on somebody.
Yeah.
And they are healed.
Let Brady know.
I believe in miracles.
Yeah.
I just think, absolutely. You know, as Christians, as modern American Christians, we don't look for them, and we don't expect them anymore.
Yep.
And that is to our fault.
Yep. Absolutely.
Pull a George Mueller.
Brady,
I'll
tell you about our story, so, but not here, but with our son in Zululand. So.
Do you have somebody that, I'm assuming it's your old pastor, because once you get there, reality is going to set in. I've seen this where, you know, you're going to question things, you're going to question, should I be here? You have somebody set up that you can reach out to and be honest with. And say we're struggling.
Yep.
Okay.
Yep. That's part of the commitment of our sending churches, is that they will be there for us to encourage us in that process.
Yes. Oh, good.
Supposedly, we'll run into those. And I'm like, I don't know.
Excellent.
I'm sure we will.
As you're sitting there without power.
Everybody mad at me because there's no power.
And all the bugs are swarming around.
All right, let's pray. Brady, would you lead us in prayer?
Heavenly Father, thank you so much. You are very God of very God. Everything about you is true and holy and righteous. And nothing happens outside of your will. Yet at the same time, you do say that whatever we do, we are to do it as unto you. And Lord, that's what you've called the worships to do. They want to go, they want to, as Paul did, they want to not build on another man's foundation. They want to translate the gospel into languages that have not yet received the gospel. And so Heavenly Father, in your name, we pray for it. There's so much to pray for, but adoration, Lord, we adore you and we love to serve you. Confession, Lord, let us always be above reproach, looking to you to confess, to share with our brothers and sisters whatever it is we might be struggling with. Adoration, confession, thanksgiving. We are so grateful for what you're doing, for the meal that we just had, for a location, for clothing, for comfort, and for health.